Hello students, I am Sunny sir from Mahdi English School. I hope all of you are fit and fine and very much healthy and watching the videos regularly and enjoying it. So, our today's video is for class 3, subject grammar. And before we begin with our video, let us see one thought. The only difference between a good and a bad day is your attitude. What is the meaning of this thought? Means, whatever happens during the day, either you can take it positively or negatively. It all depends on your attitude, on your mind. If you take it positively, your day is good. But if you take it negatively, then you will not see anything good in a day. So try to find out positive thing in each and every day. Next. So the topics which we are going to cover today in this video is, first one, the revision of kinds of sentences. We'll solve the worksheet based on kinds of sentences which we solved in the previous video. Now we'll solve some new worksheet. And number two, subject and predicate revision worksheet. So I'll just give you the brief introduction, what is subject and predicate, as I have already explained that lesson to you. And now after explaining that lesson again, after doing the revision, we'll solve the revision worksheet for the same lesson. So let us begin with our video. So, in the previous video, we had seen the kinds of the sentences. So, let us revise the kinds of the sentences again. First one is statement. What is the statement? A statement is a simple sentence with full stop. So, when you see a simple statement, the first alphabet is capital and in the end, there is a full stop. That is called a simple statement. And in the statement, we have to be very careful that there should be no question mark or no exclamation mark, because it is the rule of the statement that it must end with a full stop and it must begin with a capital letter. And sentence, the statement is something which gives you information, it informs you something. Then next, what did we see? Next we saw questions. What are questions? Questions is something that you use for asking when you don't know something, like where is my book, where were you, why were you late for the school, what is inside the blue box. So all these are called questions, and questions must end with a question mark. This is a punctuation mark that you have to learn for questions, Q for questions. And it is, see, already written over here in the definition that questions end with a question mark. So always remember this rule: statements end with full stop, questions end with a question mark. Then next one was exclamatory sentence. See, read these sentences. What a lovely flower. How high the tower is. Summer vacation begins tomorrow. So as you can see, all these sentences end with an exclamation mark. So these kind of sentences that end with an exclamation mark are called exclamatory sentences. And why do we use exclamatory sentences? For what reason? Sentences that express emotions such as joy or sorrow are called exclamatory sentences. Means happiness or sadness. When you are extremely happy or when you are extremely sad or when you are surprised, we use exclamatory sentences. But always remember that exclamatory sentence end with an exclamation mark. That is the identity of exclamatory sentence. Then next one was a command. Command, now the command means an order. For example, stand in a straight line, all the soldiers march forward, come here immediately. All these are commands, means the tone of the speaker is harsh, it is impolite. So C for command. Command means order. Now based on these 5 types of sentences that we had already revised in the previous lecture, now we will solve one exercise. Now see the exercise given over here. State whether the sentences are statements, questions or exclamatory sentences. Means from these 3 we have to identify what is the kind of the sentence. See, first one, what a beautiful house. So can you see over here, either is a statement, question or exclamatory sentence? Because in exclamatory sentence we can see exclamation mark, in questions we see question mark, in statements we see full stop. So here I can see that there is an exclamation mark over here. See, this is called exclamation mark. So because there is an exclamation mark, it is an exclamatory sentence. So how will you write? You have to write E for exclamatory sentence. Then moving on ahead, next one, are you feeling better? Is it a exclamatory sentence? No, now it is not an exclamatory sentence, it is question, because for questions we write Q and now we will write Q over here. There is a question mark, therefore it is a question. So let us write Q over here. As it is a question, I have written Q, Q for question. Then number 3, she plays the piano and he sings along. Now here you can see there is a full stop over here. It is just an information given that the girl plays the piano and the boy sings along with the girl. So this is a simple sentence with a full stop and it is called a statement. So I have written S for statement. Next, number 4, Mary loves the beach yet she hates sand. So can you see the full stop over here? So there is a full stop, means it is a simple statement. So for statement we write S. Why have I written S? Let me tell you again, there is a full stop, first alphabet capital, and it is not a question, it is not an exclamatory sentence. So the third one remaining in the option is statement, S for statement. Next one, number 5. Oh, that is a gorgeous new dress. So can you see the word oh? There is an exclamation mark over here and there is a full stop over here. But we have to identify this is an exclamatory sentence. Because there is an exclamation mark over here, this is an exclamatory sentence. Because there is a surprise that the speaker is surprised to see the new gorgeous dress. So let me put E over here. This is exclamatory. E for exclamatory sentence. Then number 6. Oh granny, what a big teeth you have. See again. Can you see over here? There is an exclamation mark. So when exclamation mark is there, it is called exclamatory sentence. E for exclamatory sentence. Next one. Do you have your homework ready? See, the speaker is asking someone, do you have your homework ready? So there is a question mark. So as it is a question mark, we have to write Q. Q for question. Because the speaker is asking someone that is he having his homework ready? So that is a question. Next one, it had rained for days. The town was flooded. So see again, there is just information given about the town that the town was flooded because it was raining for many days. And in the end, there is a full stop. So when you see full stop, it is called a statement. So I have to write S for statement. Next one, are you ready to go? See, what is the tone of the sentence? Are you ready to go? And moreover, we can see the question mark is there in the end. So as we see question mark, we have to write Q. Q for question. So I hope you have understood this exercise based on statement, exclamatory sentences and questions. So now after solving this exercise based on these 3 topics, now we will solve an exercise which is based on the mixed topics, means statement, question, exclamatory sentence, request, command. Next exercise, state whether the sentences are statements, questions, commands, exclamatory or request. Now this is the exercise based on the mixture of sentences. So we have to read the sentence, understand the sentence, and we have to find out whether it is a statement, that is S for statement, then Q for question, C for command, E for exclamatory and R for request. So first we'll read the sentence one by one and then we'll identify. The first one, why are you staring at me? So the speaker is asking someone, maybe someone is looking at him constantly, fixedly. So he is annoyed and he is asking, why are you staring at me? So this is a question. As I can see, a question mark is given over here. So let me write Q, because for question we have to write Q. So here I have written Q because it is a question. See over here, like this we have to write Q. Next one, she is such a gorgeous woman. See, the speaker is surprised to see the girl because she is gorgeous. She is very beautiful girl. So she is a gorgeous woman. And I can see exclamation mark is there over here. So that is an exclamatory sentence. And for exclamatory sentence, we write E. So as you can see on your screen, I have written E. E for exclamatory sentence. Now let's read number 3. Please don't play with fire. See, what is given over here? Please is given, please. So we all know, we have already revised this lesson before, that please is used while requesting. So it is a request, and for request we write R. So let me write R for request. So as you can see on your screen, I have written R for request, because it is a request, because you can see the word please over here. Next one, stop running in the house with your muddy shoes. So maybe the parents are scolding the child because he is running in the house. He has just come from the playground with the muddy shoes. So parents are scolding him. Stop running in the house with muddy shoes. So this is a command. It is order given to the child. So what do we have to write? C, because for command we write C. So let me write C over here. So as you can see, I have written C over here because it is command. Stop running. The command is given to the child. So I have written C over here. Next one. What a beautiful sunrise. See, what a beautiful sunrise. The tone of the sentence is very impressive and it is excitement shown over here. And moreover, I can see exclamatory mark is over here. Exclamation mark is given. So the type of the sentence is exclamatory sentence. So for exclamatory sentence, what do I write? I have to write E. E for exclamatory sentence. So as you can see here, E for exclamatory sentence. Then the next sentence is, don't make a noise. See, don't make a noise. What is it? This is a command because the tone of the sentence is harsh. Very harshly the speaker is speaking that don't make a noise. Maybe someone is harassing him, so he is annoyed. So is it command? Yes, it is a command. So what do I write? C, C for command. So for command we have to write C. Next one. Ouch, I have cut my chin. So let us assume the child was playing with his scissor and that's why he cut the chin. He got hurt with the scissor. So what is it? Can you see the exclamation mark over here? So as I can see the exclamation mark, I can understand that this sentence is exclamatory sentence, just like the fifth one. So for exclamatory sentence, we have to write E. So this is the answer. Next one, summer is my favorite time of year. See, summer is my favorite time of the year. The speaker is talking about the season. So in all, there are four seasons and he liked summer. So his favorite season is given over here. This is just an information, a simple statement. He likes summer and that is just an information. So for the statement, we just write S for statement because it is a simple statement with full stop. This is just information given. Next one, number 9, stop talking. Shouted the teacher. See, the teacher shouted at the students. Maybe they were talking, that's why they were making a lot of noise. So the teacher shouted, stop talking. Now, we can see over here, exclamation mark is there, but this is not an exclamatory sentence. Do you know why? Because the tone of the teacher, the way she spoke or the way he spoke was very harsh. The tone of the speaker is very harsh and it is very impolite tone. So we can say this is a command. They have got a command to keep quiet. So we have to write C, C for command, because the teacher has scolded them and when scolding comes, it is called a command. So we have written C, C for command. Next one, have you finished the report? See again, have you finished the report? What do you see over here? Question mark. As you can see in the end, there is a question mark given over here. So it is a question and for question we write Q. So as you can see, I have written over here Q, Q for question, because there is a question mark in the end. See, this exercise we have completed now. We have solved the exercise based on lesson 1, kinds of sentences. And this was the last exercise based on it, in which there is a mixture of all the kinds of sentences. Statement, question, command, exclamatory and request. So now after completing the worksheet of lesson 1, we shall move ahead and we shall solve the exercise of lesson number 2, that is subject and predicate. But before we solve the exercise, let us have a glance at the lesson. So this is lesson number 2, subject and predicate. So what did we learn in this lesson? That what is subject and what is predicate? As you can see on your screen, the sentences are given. The girl lost her pencil. The cat ran after the mouse. The boy is sleeping. The postman delivers letters. So all these sentences, as you can see here, there is a subject and a predicate and there is also a verb. So in a sentence, the doer of the action is called subject. See, what is the first sentence? The girl lost her pencil. So who lost the pencil? The girl. So the girl is the doer of the action. She has does the action, so she is the subject. Second one, the cat ran after the mouse. So what is the subject over there? Who ran after the mouse? Cat. Cat ran after the mouse. Then the boy is sleeping. So who is sleeping? The boy. The boy is sleeping. So the boy is subject. The postman delivers the letters. So the postman is the subject. Now you know what is subject. You have understood that the person who is doing the action is subject. And what is the rest of the sentence? For example, the girl, that is the subject. The rest of the sentence is predicate. Predicate contains one verb and the rest of the sentence. Every sentence, in each and every sentence, there are two parts. One is subject and the other is predicate. So the part which contains the doer of the action means the part which contains the person or anything which is doing the action, that is called subject, and the rest of the sentence is called predicate. And also one thing, that predicate contains one verb. There is always one verb in the predicate. See, for example, the tall girl lost her pencil. So as you can see over here, see, the sentence is divided into two parts. The tall girl lost her pencil. So as you can see over here, this part is subject and this part is predicate. How can I say? Because I'll ask the question over here, that who lost the pencil? So I can say the answer is the tall girl. She lost the pencil, right? So who lost the pencil? Again, let me tell you again, the tall girl. So when you get the answer for who, then you get the subject. And the rest of the sentence, the remaining part, the rest of the sentence is called predicate. So this was the revision of the lesson. We had understood what is subject and what is predicate. Now we can solve the exercise based on this. Again, as the worksheet, already we have solved the exercises based on this lesson. But today we will solve the exercise which are new for us. Subjects and predicates. So this is the worksheet that we have to solve. See, a subject is what the sentence is about. A predicate tells us what the subject or what the doer is doing. So subject and predicate, we have to identify the subject and predicate over here. Like I explained you, that who is doing the action, the doer, is called subject, and what action is he doing, that is called predicate. And in predicate you will always see one verb is there. See, first one is already done for you. The new computer works fast. So in this sentence, the new computer works fast. For example, I'll ask what works fast. I cannot ask who, because it is a thing. So what works fast? So my answer is the new computer. So that is our subject, and they have underlined the subject, and predicate they have circled. What is the predicate? Works fast. So this is the verb. Works is an action word. Works, plays, writes, all these are verbs. And in predicate always we will see one verb is there. So like this, we have to underline the subject and circle the predicate. So let us solve the exercise now. Number 2. My mom and dad drive to the city together to work every day. See, my mom and dad drive to the city together to work every day. So can I ask the question, who? Who drives to the city every day? Who comes every day to the city? Who drives to the city every day? So my answer is my mom and dad. My mom and dad drive to the city together every day. So I have underlined the subject. What is the subject? My mom and dad, because they drive to the city every day. If I ask the question who drives, then the answer is my mom and dad, because they are performing the action, they are driving. And the rest of the sentence is predicate. So as you can see, I have circled the predicate, and subject I have underlined. My mom and dad is subject, and the rest of the sentence is predicate. What is the verb over here? The verb is drive. Drive is the verb. It is an action that is being done. So drive is the verb. Then sentence number 3. Tim, our new baseball coach, will have practice on Sundays. So who will have practice on Sundays? Who will have practice? So our answer is Tim. So because Tim is the subject, we have to underline the subject. So let us underline the subject now. Tim is our subject because it is the name of a person. And the rest of the sentence, what is our rest of the sentence? Our new baseball coach will have practices on Sunday. So can we just circle it? So I have circled the predicate. The rest of the sentence is our predicate. Now sentence number 4. My cousins Ron and Kelly live in an apartment in Chicago. So it is about cousins Ron and Kelly. So what is the subject over here? So the answer is my cousins Ron and Kelly live in an apartment in Chicago. So as you can see, I have underlined the subject and I have circled the predicate. How did I know that this is the subject? Because it is the name of a person and these are the two cousins' name. So that is the subject, because they perform an action. And what action do they perform? The action of living. And in the predicate part, we have one verb. What is the verb over here? To live. Live is the verb. and this rest of the sentence which I have circled is the predicate part. Now let's move ahead to the next sentence. A little yellow fish swam by us in the ocean. So as you can see, the little yellow fish is given over here. It is swimming near in the ocean. So now let us underline the subject. So you can see on your screen, I have underlined the subject, a little yellow fish. So these words are describing the fish. It is little and of yellow color. And the rest of the sentence, swam by us in the ocean, that is predicate because this contains extra information about the fish. What did the fish do? It swam. The word swam is the past tense of swim. So the fish swims in the ocean. The word swam is our verb. And in all the sentences I told you, there will be subject, predicate and verb. Now next sentence. My favorite teacher inspired me to study science. So who is the speaker talking about? Who inspired him to study science? Who inspired him? Who gave him inspiration? So his favorite teacher gave him inspiration. So that is the subject. Who did the action? His favorite teacher. So my favorite teacher is the subject. And the rest of the sentence, inspired me to study science, that is called predicate because it contains a verb. And what is the verb over there? What is the verb inspired? Inspired is the verb because that is an action of inspiring someone. So inspired is the verb over here. Next sentence, the loud music makes me want to dance. So the speaker is very fond of dancing. Maybe he likes songs and he likes dancing. So as soon as he hears the music, he wants to dance. He cannot stop himself. So here, what makes him dance? You have to ask the question, what? What makes him want to dance? What makes him that he likes dancing? So as you can see on your screen, I have underlined the subject and circled the predicate, the loud music. What makes him dance? We have to ask the question, what? So we get the answer, the loud music, very high sound music. And makes me want to dance. So over here you can see, what is the verb? The verb is makes, because that is an action performed. So let us underline the verb makes, that is action, action performed by the speaker. Christmas and Thanksgiving are my favorite holidays. So here you can see, the speaker has described his favorite holidays. Which are his favorite holidays? These two, Christmas and Thanksgiving. So these two are the nouns, these two are the subjects. You can ask that, which are the favorite holidays of the speaker? Which are his favorite holidays? So we can understand that his favorite holidays are these two. So these two are called subject of the sentence. So let us underline the subject of the sentence, Christmas and Thanksgiving. That much is the subject. And what about the rest of the part? The rest of the part is called predicate. So just circle the predicate part, are my favorite holidays. And what is the verb over here? Is there any main verb over here? No, there is no main verb. The only verb over here is are. Are is an helping verb, not the, are is a helping verb, not the main verb. Next one, we are getting a new refrigerator for the kitchen. So what are they getting? They are getting new refrigerator. But here we can ask the question, who? Because the person who is performing the action, who is performing the action, or how many people are performing the action? All are performing the action together. We means more than one. So who is going to get the new refrigerator for the kitchen? So I have already underlined the subject and the predicate part. Who is getting the new refrigerator? We are going to get the new refrigerator. So the performing action is done by we, means so many people are performing the action. And are getting, over here it is the verb, ing form of the verb is given, and we don't have the main verb, we have the ing form of the verb. So the action is being performed by we, means many people are there. Next one, the clues to the mystery will help us solve it. So what is given over here? The clues to the mystery will help us solve it. So what is going to help you to solve the mystery? How will you solve the mystery? For example, police is solving a case and they need some evidence. So that is called clues. If they have the clues, and they can easily solve the case, they can easily solve the mystery. So our subject over here is the clues. So as you can see, I have underlined the whole subject, the main subject part, the main noun is this, the clues, but it is adding more meaning. So I have underlined the whole subject. There can be a complete subject and the main subject. So I have underlined the whole subject over here. So you can also underline the clues, but I have underlined the whole subject. And the rest of the sentence, will help us solve it, is the predicate part. and also there is one helping verb in the predicate part. What is the helping verb? What is the modal verb given over here? That is will. Will is the modal verb, not the main verb. So this is subject and the rest of the sentence is predicate. So we have solved the exercise based on subject and predicate. We have identified what is subject, what is predicate. We have underlined the subject, we have circled the predicate, and we also understood what are verbs. So again, can we see the answers on the screen? Yes, the new computer, that is the answer, and this is predicate. My mom and dad, subject, and the rest of the sentence is predicate. Then Tim, our new basketball coach, that is subject, and the rest is predicate. Next one, my cousins Ron and Kelly, that much is the subject, the rest of the sentence is predicate. Then number 5, a little yellow fish. So a little yellow fish is subject, the rest of the sentence is predicate. Number 6, my favorite teacher. So my favorite teacher is the subject, the rest is the predicate part. Then number 7, the loud music, that is the subject, the rest of the sentence is predicate. Next one, Christmas and Thanksgiving, that is the subject, remaining is the predicate part. Next, number 9, we, that is subject, we is the plural form, means many people are performing the action, and the rest is the predicate. Next, the clues to the mystery, that is the subject, and the remaining part is the predicate part. So we have a new exercise over here. What is the heading? Read the group of words given below. Tell whether each group of words could be a subject or predicate. Write subject or predicate on the line next to each phrase. So here we have to read the groups of the words which are given to us. Then we have to identify whether the groups are subject or predicate. How will you identify? In predicate, it is one easy way. That is, if verb is given, action word is given, then it is predicate. And if verb is not given, if someone's name is given, or if the person who is performing the action is given, then it is called subject. So first we will find the verb. If verb is given, then it is called predicate, otherwise it is subject. First one, ran down the sidewalk. So see, ran down the sidewalk. Can you see the word ran over here? So that ran, that word is a verb. So verb is given, that's why it is called predicate. So we have to write predicate over here. So as you can see, I have written the answer predicate. Why have I written? Because there is one verb, ran, that's why it is predicate. Number 2, knew all the answers. Someone, maybe the student is very intelligent, he knew all the answers. So is there any verb over here? Yes, knew. Knew is the past tense of know. So it is also a verb. The students knew all the answers, that is action of knowing the answers. So when verb is given, again it is a predicate. So let me write the answer. So again, in number 2, the answer is predicate because we have a verb and the verb is new. Here the verb is ran. I will show the answers in the end again, don't worry. Number 3, the boy is in my class. See, now here, read the phrase carefully. The boy is in my class. Now this is something incomplete. But can I see the verb over here? No, the verb is not given over here. So the verb is not given, the doer is given. Who is performing the action? The boys. So that is called subject because the verb is not given. So here we have to write subject. So this is the subject because the verb is missing in this phrase. Number 4, growled and grunted. So here this is the action. Action performed by someone, growling and grunting. So as these are both the verbs, there is no subject over here. Who is growling, who is grunting, we don't know. But the action words are given, growling and grunting. So that is called predicate because these are the verbs. So the answer is over here. The answer is predicate. Then number 5, my favorite toy. See, my favorite toy, whose favorite toy, we don't know. But we can see the pronoun my. So maybe it is about a person, a boy or a girl, we don't know. But still, the verb is not given over here. Is the verb given? No. What with my favorite toy? What action is performed? We don't know. So when the action performed, we don't know. Only the subject is given over here. Whose favorite toy? My favorite toy. So this is subject because the verb is missing in this. So let me write over here subject. So here is the answer. Number 5, that is subject, my favorite toy. Number 6, the video game. But what about the video game? There is no verb over here. Can you see the video game? It is only the subject part. Verb is missing. So again, we have to write over here subject. So here is answer number 6, the video game subject. Then number 7, need a new motor. Needed a new motor. So needed is the past tense of need. And again, now here we can see the verb, that is needed, to need something. So when verb is given, it is called predicate. Let me write predicate over here. So number 7 is predicate because we see the verb needed. Then number 8, smiled. Now this is only one word and this is a verb. Again, verb is given, so same like this, we have to write over here predicate. So you can see I have put the answer in number 8, smiled is predicate. Number 9, my father's friend. See, here the person is given, my father's friend, but what is he doing, what action is he performing, we don't know. So my father's friend, that is the subject part, because the action is not performed over here, it is only subject, the noun is given. Then last but not the least, the tiny mosquito. Now the tiny mosquito, what is it doing, we don't know. Maybe it bites the person, but here it is not given bites, the verb is missing. So this is only the subject part, because verb is missing and the verb is in predicate part. So predicate part is not given, that's why this is called subject part. So let me write over here subject. So number 10 is subject, because there is no verb given over here. Now we can see all the answers again. I said I'll show you the answers. So here are the answers: predicate, predicate, subject, predicate, subject, subject, predicate, predicate, subject, and the last one is again subject. So I hope with today's video all of you have understood kinds of sentences, as we have solved the exercises based on it, and also we have solved one exercise based on subject and predicate. And in the next video we'll solve more exercises based on subject and predicate. Till then, all of you take care of yourself. Goodbye and have a blessed day. Thank you.